What exactly is a model? This may seem like a rhetorical question, but it is in fact fundamental to architecture and, perhaps more to the point this, our approach to architecture. And while this also may sound obvious, it's worth placing at the forefront of our minds when talking about model making that a model is not a reality, but an abstraction of a reality. That is, of course, unless and until you build an object as a real-life structure and then use that structure itself as a prototype or model for something else, in which case your model is then both a reality and an abstraction of yet another reality. And in architecture, this happens all the time. And it brings us more or less directly to the even more pertinent question, what is the model for? Because irrespective of how big or how small the model is, how detailed or how rudimentary, just how abstract or lifelike, no matter how it was made, whether by hand or by a digital manufacturing process, the important thing about the model is really what it is used for. Is it used merely to represent a proposed architectural reality, or is it used to develop a concept? Is it used to illustrate a design or to design, to demonstrate thinking or to think? From this unit in our MOOC, as from the companion chapter in the Atlas of Digital Architecture, you will get a strong sense that we view model making as part of a process, namely one of developing, designing, thinking, learning and experiencing. We postulate it as an intuitive learning process that helps us gain implicit knowledge, knowledge that we can't obtain simply from studying architecture, but that we internalize and absorb through our senses. This means that whichever way you do it, model making is something that takes practice, and it presupposes a dedication to the process itself, as opposed to a simple desire to finish the thing so it's done and can be shown to someone who needs to see it as quickly as possible. Consequently, we also here see model making as a process that never ends, at least not for as long as the project is live. There doesn't come a natural point where the modeling is done and we can now get on with the job of building the real thing. The idea of using modeling as a cyclical design process is that you improve complex systems in terms of their form, their material, and their function continuously, and for as long as this is practical, right until the project is up and can be handed over. And even then, depending on what kind of a project we're dealing with, it may be the case that the now built real-life object is still a work in progress and that the learnings and findings from how it behaves and functions in the real world and how it is used by real people will feed into its further development and management or into future projects of a comparable nature. If you view model making as a learning process, then you can also argue that the point of the model is to help you outwit nature, because with a model you can work out how to do things that weren't possible before. If you want to learn how to fly, for example, you're going to have to build some models first of your flying machine that will make you magnificent. If you want to build a tower that is taller than any ever built before, you could start by just constructing it, but your chances of success would be not much greater than those of the master builders of Babel. You really best find out if your dream is achievable by making some models to test the structure, the materials, the statics, the dimensions, the physics, let alone the aesthetics and economics of your undertaking. If you want to employ new materials in new combinations to achieve whole new spatial sensations, your path to fulfillment, more likely than not, will lead you along the making of many a model. With the model, you can take a step outside nature and find out the mechanics of what it is you're trying to do, how the thing that didn't exist before could actually work. And that may well be the real purpose of the physical model. Whichever way you arrive at it, be it by joining pieces of wood, moulding clay, assembling metal, or by constructing your vision on a computer and then printing it out, or using any of the many other digital manufacturing processes available to you, if you don't learn anything from making your model, well, then your model is just a smaller or simpler, more abstract version of a bigger or more complex, more real-life thing. It may be pretty, it may be illustrative, and it may even have a point in existing for the particular reason that it is either or both of these things, but that then is all there is to it. And that's not very much compared to what a model can be. And so, while in the early to mid-1980s, as computer technology and CAD started to make themselves widely felt in architecture, it may have looked as if the physical model would soon be a thing of the past. The opposite turns out to be the case. The demise of the physical model has not only not materialized, but in fact, since then, there has been a veritable revival of physical model making. As a result of CAD and 3D modeling, the physical model has become more prevalent and more important and more integrated into the design process than possibly at any stage since the Renaissance. And perhaps this is in itself not a coincidence, seeing that we find ourselves, as we point out repeatedly throughout this MOOC, in a digital Renaissance.